is no different than what he did to the men who came up to him talking about, I will follow you. He told him, foxes ain't got no darn holes. You sure you want to follow me? He made sure it was full disclosure. Paul took after the same thing. He went to the people and he was preaching to the people in Ephesus. And he says, I didn't hold back from you the fullness of the counsel of God. Full disclosure. That's what it's about, making sure people understand what they're getting into. If they don't understand, then they get halfway there and want to turn around. That's what Luke chapter 14 about to tell us. Luke chapter 14, verse 25. Well, Sabbath peace.
Sabbath peace.
It's another opportunity for us to come together and hear and learn the word of truth that's given to us by the Most High God. All honor goes to the Father through the Son, through Yahushua. In him lies the only hope for salvation. We know that salvation is obtained by grace through faith, not of works, lest anyone should boast, and given freely as a gift to all who obey him. We understand that if we do not obey him, it is made manifest or made obvious that we do not believe. In this state, we should expect no good thing from the Most High. However, anything that we do get, whether it be a gift of tongues, a gift of prophecy, or any supernatural experience that we may have, it can and it will be used against us in the day of judgment. With that said, peace to the saints that are in the room, to the saints that couldn't make it, to the saints watching on the camera. But no peace to the wicked. The only ones we said, the only thing we say to them is repent that they might live. We're going to open up Isaiah chapter 28, verse 9. Try John chapter 8, verse 17. I wish you were writing it down last week because I think I want to say that's what it was. John chapter 8, verse 16, maybe.
You sure it wasn't 644? You wouldn't forget that, huh?
Nah. That'd be good, too. Matter of fact, we'll fall back. If this ain't what I'm looking for, that's what we're going to go to.
We can do 15?
15?
No, 14.
14. It's John chapter 8, verse 14. That's what I'm looking for?
No, I'm saying that we can start from there. Good stuff.
Yep.
Yahushua answered and said unto them, though I bear record of myself, yet my record is true.
Uh-huh.
For I know whence I came and where I go. But you cannot tell where I come and where I go.
He said, you don't know where I came from. You don't know where I'm going. Right? He said, my record would be true because I know where I came from and where I go. Right? He said, if I tell you something, you can believe it. Because I know where I know where I came from and I know where I'm going. But you don't know where I came from and you don't know where I'm going. Why?
Ye judge after the flesh. I judge no man.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, if I judge, my judgment is true.
He said, if I did judge somebody, I think it'd be true. Because we know he told us right now, he said he judges no man. That's right now. Right? But in the judgment, all judgment will be given to him. Right? That's what confuses people. That's why we had this dispute about if we can judge people, don't judge people, don't judge me. Because they don't understand. They don't understand the end. And we're going to talk a whole lot about the end once we get to get through Acts. And we're going to talk a little bit about Revelations. But let's keep going.
And yet if I judge, my judgment is true, for I am not alone, but I am the Father that sent me.
Uh-huh.
It is also written in your law that the testimony of two men is true. I am one that bear witness of myself, and my Father that sent me bears witness of me.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me. Then said they unto him, where is thy Father? Yahushua answered, ye neither know me nor my Father. If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also.
Mm-hmm.
These words spake Yahushua in the treasury as he taught in the temple. And no man laid hands on him, for his hour was not yet come.
Keep going.
Then said Yahushua again unto them, I go my way, and ye shall seek me, and shall die in your sins. Whither I go, ye cannot come.
Okay. And they asked him what?
Then said the Jews, will he kill himself because he says, where I go, ye cannot come?
Uh-huh.
And he said to them, ye are from beneath, I am from above. Ye are from this world, I am not of this world. I said therefore unto you that
Yahushua sound real stuck up, don't he? Alright? We listen to it's important that when we speak to him, we put it in real terms. You gotta pretend like you don't know nothing about this man and he's standing here and he's talking this same type of language to you. You gotta listen to a man say, I mean, y'all from beneath. You know what I'm saying? Y'all from here. I'm from above. I'm above y'all. Alright? I'm from somewhere way above y'all. Y'all from beneath. Y'all don't know nothing about where I come from. Y'all don't know where I'm going. Right? You have to understand, this is how he is speaking to the regular people. Right? Keep going.
Then said they unto him, Who art thou? And Yahshua said unto them, Even the same that I said unto you from the beginning. I have many things to say and to judge of you. But he that sent me is true, and I speak to the world those things which I have heard of him.
Uh-huh.
They understood not that he spake to them of the Father. Then said Yahshua unto them, When you have lift up the Son of Man, then shall you know that I am he, and that I do nothing of myself, but as my Father has taught me, I speak these things.
Uh-huh.
And he that sent me is with me. The Father has not left me alone, for I do always those things that please him. As he spake these words, many believed on him.
Mm-hmm.
Then said Yahshua to the Jews, those Jews which believed on him, If ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples.
He said, If you do what?
If you continue in my word.
What do we call that?
Obedient,
maybe we call that, yeah, that's obedient for sure. We could, maybe we call that a condition. All right, yeah. You put that if on the front of it. You know what I'm saying? He said, If you continue in my word, then what? You'll be my
then
Christian.
Are ye my disciples indeed.
You'll be my Hebrew Israelite. He said, Then you'll be my disciple indeed. You can be a Christian all you want to do. Ain't no value. It ain't no promise connected to it. All right? You can be a Hebrew Israelite all you want to do. Ain't no promise connected to it. All right? The only promise connected to obedience. Right? You obey the Son. You got a promise connected to that because you're a disciple at that point. That's what we look to be, disciples. Not Hebrew Israelites. Not Christians. Not all this other stuff, because the book doesn't promise us anything. Our whole goal has to be looking for the promise. Keep going. I still ain't found what I'm looking for. I'm hoping this is in chapter 8 somewhere.
And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free.
Uh-huh. What verse is that?
32.
I like that too.
32.
So I want 31 next time. Keep going.
They answered him, We be Abraham's seed, and we're never in bondage to any man. Mm-hmm. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? Yahshua answered them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, Whosoever commits sin is the servant of sin, and the servant abides not in the house forever, but the Son abides forever.
Mm-hmm.
If the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed.
He said, You'll be free indeed.
I know that ye are Abraham's seed, but ye seek to kill me, because my word has no place in you. I speak that which I have seen with my Father, and ye do that which ye have seen with your father. They answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. And Yahshua said unto him, If ye were Abraham's children, ye would do the works of Abraham.
Mm-hmm.
But now ye seek to kill me, a man that has told you the truth, which I have heard of God. This did not Abraham. Ye do the deeds of your father. Then they said to him, We be not born of fornication. We have one father, even God. And Yahshua said to them, If God were your father, you would love me.
He said, If God was your father, you would love me.
For I proceeded forth and came from God. Mm-hmm. Neither came I of myself, but he sent me. Why do ye not understand my speech, even because you cannot hear my word? Ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father ye will do.
He said, Ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father ye will do. All right.
He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it.
Mm-hmm.
And because I tell you the truth, ye believe me not. Which of you convinces me of sin? Convicteth me of sin. And if I say the truth, why do ye not believe me? He that is of God hears God's words. Ye therefore hear them not, because mm-hmm. you are not of God.
Mm-hmm.
Then answered the Jews and said unto him, Say we not well that thou art a Samaritan and has a devil?
All right. He said, so but what they're saying is, are we not correct? That when they say we not well, what they really saying, are we not speaking correctly when we say that you are a Samaritan and you have a devil? They try to take some shots at him. Like, boy, you a Samaritan, you a Gentile. You know what I'm saying? You have a mixed seed and you have a devil, boy. You know what I'm saying? Ain't we telling the truth when we say that? This man talking about dying, this ain't what I'm looking for. We about to switch. Go ahead and keep going, though. I just want to finish this part out.
Yahshua answered, I am not a devil. I have not a devil, but I honor my Father, and ye do dishonor me. And I seek not my own glory. There is one that seeks and judge. Verily, verily, I say unto you, if a man keep my saying, he shall never see death.
If a man keep my saying, he shall never see death. What verse is that?
51.
Where do we start? 14?
Yeah.
Do John 7, 14. I know it's not 6. It can't be 6. If it ain't this, then we just going to go to 6. There's some good stuff in 6.
Now about the midst of the feast, Yahshua went up into the temple and taught. And the Jews marveled, saying, how knoweth this man letters, having
yes,
never learned?
Yes, there we go. That's exactly what I want. It's John chapter 7, verse 14.
Now about the midst of the feast, Yahshua went up into the temple and taught. And the Jews marveled, saying, how knoweth this man letters, having never learned?
Mm-hmm.
And Yahshua answered them and said, my doctrine is not mine, but his that sent me.
He said, my doctrine is not mine, but it is his that sent me. The man is sitting there, he's teaching, and he's teaching out of a letter. When they say the letter, they're talking about the books, right? He opened up the books on him. He's looking at them, and he's teaching out of the books. And they saying, how does man know the book like that? How does no man know the Bible like that? And he ain't even go to school for it. Like, he didn't go to no seminary classes. How does he know it like that? Watch what happened next. He said, my doctrine is not my doctrine. What else?
But his that sent me.
But he said, it's his that sent me. What else?
If any man will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself.
He said, if you do the will of God, you will know if you know or if you're hearing the right doctrine. That's what it comes down to. We have to be able to do the will of God. By doing the will of God, according to Yahushua, you will know if his doctrine false or if the doctrine is true. Right? That's why it always comes down, no matter how you twist and turn and slice this book up, how you divide the book up, if you're honest about it, it always will come back down to obedience being the litmus test, being the deciding factor in what you know, what you do, and where you're going. Alright? Always back to obedience. Grab Psalm chapter 122.
Psalms what?
122. It's Psalm chapter 122. Make sure we understand the book. If we don't understand the book, how are we going to do his will? If we don't do his will, how are we going to understand the book? It all go hand in hand. He said, the doctrine I have is not my doctrine. Anybody who do his will know if I speak the doctrine of myself or if the doctrine come from the Father. This is just chapter 1. I mean, chapter 122, verse 1.
I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feet shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
Jerusalem is builded as a city that is compact together. Whether the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, unto the testimony of Israel, to give thanks unto the name of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
For there are set thrones of judgment, the thrones of the house of David.
Mm-hmm.
Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. They shall prosper that love thee.
Mm-hmm.
Peace be within thy walls, and prosperity within thy places. For my brethren and companions' sake, I will now say, peace be within thee. Because of the house of the Lord, our God will seek, our Lord, our God, I will seek thy good.
All right. So we want to seek the good of the house of our God, right? He said, I will seek thy good, right? So in other words, we seeking the good of our land and what God gave us, right? That was our mindset. Watch this.
That was it.
Oh, that's the whole thing?
Mm-hmm.
Grab Isaiah chapter 66, verse 1.
Uh-huh. Thus says the Lord, the heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. Where is the house that ye build unto me?
So now when we seeking the good of the house, well, the Most High God is looking at us like, man, where's the house that you going to build me? We're talking about the house that we built. Right? Most High God said, man, this whole thing is my throne. What house you going to build for me if I fill up the whole earth? Right? But we seeking the good of what we built him. This is Mark chapter 1. We got to understand the house first. It's Mark chapter 1, verse 9.
And it came to pass in those days that Yahshua came from Nazareth of Galilee.
Mm-hmm.
And was baptized of John in Jordan. And straightway coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens open and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him.
So he saw the heavens open. He saw the Spirit like a dove descending upon him.
And there came a voice from heaven saying, thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.
All right. So there goes the water, the Spirit, and then the voice of the Most High God. All right. What else?
And immediately the Spirit driveth him into the wilderness. And he was there in the wilderness 40 days, tempted of Satan. And was with the wild beasts, and the angels ministered unto him.
Mm-hmm.
Now after that, John was put in prison. Yahshua came into Galilee.
What verse is that?
14.
He
preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God, and saying, the time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye, and believe the gospel.
He said, do what now? He said, the time is fulfilled.
And the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye, and believe the gospel.
Why he didn't tell them, just ask for forgiveness and get on your knees and pray? Why he didn't tell them it don't really matter what you do now because Yahushua is about to die for our sins? Right? He gave them the instruction. He said, repent ye. Right? How do we know what repent is? We talked about it. Ezekiel, right? Ezekiel told us. Ezekiel told us very clearly. Ezekiel 18. He said, repent and turn ye from all your transgressions. We know repenting is turning from all transgressions. Not just turning from the few that's difficult for us or the few that we feel most proud about. Right? We got to turn from all transgressions. We do that. He said he'll forget everything in the past. That's the mechanism. We look at this like it's a New Testament feature. It's not. This is the mechanism that was already set in the old. If you repent from your wickedness, I will not remember your wickedness. That's the mechanism in which he's able to give us something new. Give us a new heart and a new spirit. Keep going. He said, repent, because the kingdom is at hand.
Now, as he walked by the sea
mm-hmm.
of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And Yahshua said unto them, come ye after me, and I will make you to become fishers of men.
Mm-hmm.
And straightway they forsook their nets and followed him.
Straightway they did it?
Straightway.
So they didn't have no discussion, no nothing. They just saw the man and they just ran with it. That don't make a whole lot of sense at first. You look at it, be like, okay, so Yahushua, he get baptized. He just get up and all of a sudden people just go with it. You think they just went with it just because he was cute or something? Let's see. This is, what verse is that?
18.
Keep going. You can go a couple.
And when he had gone a little further thence, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who also were in the ship mending their nets.
Uh-huh.
And straightway he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the ship with the hired servants and went after him.
Mm-hmm.
And they went into Capernaum, and straightway on the Sabbath day he entered into the synagogue and taught. And they were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one that had authority and not as the scribes.
So it was just like what we read in John chapter 7, right? When they looked at the man, like, man, how he teach out of the letters? And he don't even, like, he ain't never even been to school. He ain't been in no seminary class. And so he was teaching out of them. Now, in this one, they is like, man, he teach like somebody who got some authority. He ain't teaching it like the scribes. Because, you know, like me, when I teach the book, I can be like, yeah, this is what it means and this, that, and the other. And I'm telling you what it means. I'm telling you problems and this, that, and the other. He said, not in Yahushua's case. The man teaching like he been there. Like he did it. Right? He teaching like he got some authority. Like he can command some things. Right? That's what we look at. We have to make sure we understand that this is a difference. And you could tell the difference when this man talked. That's why they're following him. Right? This is Luke chapter 3, verse 7. Luke chapter 3, verse 7. This is Luke chapter 3, verse 7.
Then said he to the multitude that came forth to be baptized of him, O generation of vipers, who has warned you to flee from the wrath to come?
This is John the Baptist again. This is telling it from Luke's point of view. What we just read in Mark, this is now the same thing told from Luke's point of view. So he said, who warned y'all to escape what's to come? He said, y'all some vipers. All right, keep going. Y'all some snakes. You know what I'm saying? He said, who tried to tell y'all about the wrath that was going to come on y'all? Y'all coming down here to try to repent and to try to get baptized. Why wasn't John the Baptist a good Christian? He just said, everybody, just come as you are. Why he calling them vipers when they come? They coming to try to change their life. Why he calling them vipers? Like, we don't think about this when we read a lot of stuff we get offended by. And we like, oh, a man of God would never do that today. And a lot of these dudes ain't men of God when they do this stuff. But at the same time, we can't allow ourselves to be offended by optics or something just because it don't fit in what people told us things should go. We got to look at our book. Why we ain't offended when John the Baptist look at these people that's coming to change their life, and the only thing he can say to them is, who warned y'all to come from, who try to escape the wrath? Ain't that what they supposed to do? Why he challenging them about it? All right, let's keep going.
Bring forth therefore fruits worthy of repentance.
He told them, if you're going to do that, you better bring forth fruits that's worthy of repentance. In other words, you need to do stuff that shows clearly that you've changed. Right? It always comes back to our behavior. Right? You always got to put something on the line. Got to sacrifice. We're about to look at these men that Yahushua called. Right? When he walked up to them and said, just follow me. And they just stopped what they're doing and straightway followed them. These men didn't do it without sacrifice. And they didn't do it because they thought the man was beautiful or looked good. Thought he had comeliness. Right? They did it because they saw the man had something to say and they trusted it. The Most High God moved and drew on their spirit. Right? Let's keep going.
And begin not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham to our father.
This is John the Baptist talking still. He said, begin not to say we have Abraham as our father. That's what these Hebrew Israelites be talking about. We the seed of Abraham. We the seed of Isaac and Jacob. Yep, you sure are. Let's see what John the Baptist got to say.
For I say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham.
So if he could raise up children from Abraham, you think he can't raise them up from the Gentiles? You think he can't even raise them up from these fake Jewish people? That's going to be a sad day for a lot of these Hebrew Israelites. They learn we Hebrews. They learn that these people have been impersonating our people for years. And they find out some of them going to enter into the kingdom before us. Right? That thing gonna hurt some real feelings at that point. Right? But that's what we have to get through our head. Most like God, he ain't worried about none of this stuff. What he worried about is you doing what he's talking about. If you not doing what he's talking about, why he gonna be worried about whether you Hebrew or not? I can fix that. I'll raise up some Hebrews from some rocks. What you talking about? Right? Let's keep going. We gotta make sure that we're ready to put our life on the line and put something on the line for this. Keep going.
That God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. And now also the axe is laid unto the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, which brings not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire.
Mm-hmm.
The people asked him, saying, what shall we do then?
Mm-hmm.
And he answered and said unto them, he that has two coats, let him impart to him that has none.
Mm-hmm.
And he that has meat, let him do likewise. Then came also publicans to be baptized and said unto him, Master, what shall we do? And he said unto them, Exact no more than that which is appointed you. And the soldiers likewise demanded of him, saying, And what shall we do? And he said unto them, Do violence to no man, neither accuse any falsely, and be content with your wages. And as the people were in expectation, and all men mused in their hearts of John, mm-hmm. whether he were the Christ or not, John answered, saying unto them all, I indeed baptize you with water. But one mightier than I comes, the latchet of whose shoes I am not worthy to unloose, he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire,
mm-hmm.
whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor, mm-hmm. and will gather the wheat into his garner, but the chaff he will burn with the fire unquenchable.
Mm-hmm.
And many other things in this exhortation preached he unto the people. But Herod the Tetrarch, being reproved by him for Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, and for all the evils which Herod had done. 19.
Grab Luke chapter 9 for me. It's Luke chapter 9, verse 57. Only way you're going to be able to be a disciple is you continue in his word. That's what John the Baptist is trying to tell us. He said, if you got one coat, they asked him. You see, it's a very important question that they asked. What shall we do? Right? If that hasn't become a question for us, then our focus may not be right. Right? When we come to this, our question has to be, what do I need to do? Right. If you notice, if you go to a lot of Christian churches and all that, they stay away from that. I know it's not about works. Don't worry about only thing you need to do is just believe. Right. Because that's a valid question. And the answer to that question has implications that makes people uncomfortable. That's why John the Baptist flatly told him, you got two coats, go give one to somebody who ain't got nothing. Right. You got food. You got more food to eat. Go give some food to somebody who ain't got no food, right? You a publican, another way, a tax collector. Only man, what these people tell you to collect, only collect that. Don't be trying to collect no extra, right? He didn't tell him, don't do your job, right? He told him, whatever you appointed, that's what you collect. He said, you a soldier, you know what I'm saying? You an officer, you a soldier. Don't do no violence and don't falsely accuse nobody. Don't be out there being crooked. In other words, he's saying, look out for people and do your job. He didn't tell them, stop being a soldier. Don't be a soldier for Rome. Right? He said, if you're a soldier, you know what I'm saying? Just do your job. Just don't do no violence to people. Don't be out there treating people wrong. And don't falsely accuse nobody. This way is not hard. This way is easy. Just be decent people. Obey the Most High God. Not decent according to these people. Don't be decent according to the people at your job. Be decent according to the book. Right? It's not a hard way. We just been conditioned to think everything that's wrong is good and comfortable. We just got to get out of these mindsets and break habits. Right? This is Luke chapter 9. Chapter 9, verse 57.
And it came to pass that as they went in the way, a certain man said unto him, Lord, I will follow thee whithersoever you go.
He said, I will follow thee wherever you go.
And Yahushua said unto him, Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has not where to lay his head.
So isn't it interesting that John the Baptist, when they came to him trying to change their life, John the Baptist first thing came out of his mouth, man, y'all some vipers. You know what I'm saying? Y'all some vipers. Who warned y'all about this? Who warned y'all about the wrath that's coming your way? Y'all gonna come around here and try to escape it by changing your life. Right? He said, y'all some darn vipers. Right? Now they coming to Yahushua, and they like, man, I will follow you wherever you go. Yahushua didn't say, oh, praise God. I'm so happy that you're willing to follow me. First thing he said is, you do know that foxes don't have holes. In other words, I'm like a fox. I ain't got no hole to sleep in, right? I ain't got nowhere to lay my head now. He's trying to warn them. He's letting them know, this is what you have up against you. John the Baptist, the same thing. He let them know. Okay, who warned y'all about this? Well, you know you're going to have to bear fruits that's worthy of repentance. What shall we do? You got two goats. You better get them things up. He let them know, this is what you have to look forward to. This is what you have up against. It's important that we let people know up front, this is the way. Right? This is the way. We were talking just before the camera cut on. Right? Talking about, man, you know, there's a whole lot of people that's in their second marriage. What are we going to do? Lie to them? We going to pretend like, oh, let's not even talk about that subject. What does that do for anybody? We got to let them know. Right? They ain't going to do it. They ain't going to change. They going to stay with their second husband, second wife. That's on them. But at least we let them know, this is what you have up against you if you want to come this way. Right? If you want to make it and see the Most High God in the end of this thing, you're going to have to leave your husband. You're going to have to leave your second wife. Leave your second wife. You're going to have to leave your second husband. Right? There's no other way around it. Just like any other sin. Right? It's adultery according to the book. Right? The man clearly tells us. He said, if anybody, right, divorce his wife, he commits adultery and he causes her to commit adultery. So if she committing adultery, you committing adultery, then how you expect to get into the kingdom? Right? It's important that we know these things and we understand what's up again. Not everybody is willing to do it. It's better off to find out you ain't willing than to keep walking, get halfway there and be like, you know what? Nah, I ain't into it. All right? Keep going.
And he said unto another, follow me. But he said, Lord, suffer me first to go and bury my father. And Yahshua said unto him, let the dead bury their dead, but go thou and preach the kingdom of God.
Uh-huh.
And another said, Lord, I will follow thee, but let me first go bid them farewell which are at home in my house.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahshua said unto him, no man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God.
So you see, he's not saying no encouraging words to these guys. He's letting them know, you follow me, you got to be all in. It's a difference between their attitude and the attitude of some of the people who ended up being disciples, ended up being apostles. Right? When John and James, they just followed straight away. He called them, they just hopped in. Peter, all of them, okay, let's go. Right? They followed straight away. Right? When it comes down to the other ones, it's tough. They're like, man, look, I'll follow you. Well, you know I ain't got nowhere to stay. You do understand I ain't got nowhere to stay, right? All right? I mean, just let me go, you know what I'm saying, go tell my people. You do know that anybody who put his hand to the plow and then turn back, they ain't fit for my kingdom, right? Let's keep going.
That was the end of it.
Grab Luke chapter 14. Matter of fact, before we grab that, grab Acts chapter 21. I don't know where we left off, but Acts chapter 21, maybe verse. Or did we get over into 22? I don't even know. It's Acts chapter 21. Give me, what's the last verse?
We left off.
Should have left off when James was telling him what to do to, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, you make his vow.
What was that, 21?
We're on like 23.
23? It's verse 23. It's Acts chapter 21, verse 23.
Do therefore this that we say unto thee. We have four men which have a vow on them.
Mm-hmm.
Them take and purify thyself with them and be at charges with them, that they may shave their heads and all may know that those things whereof they are informed concerning you are nothing. But that you yourself also walk orderly and keep the law. As touching the Gentiles which believe, we have written and concluded that they observe no such thing, except only that they keep themselves from things offered to idols, and from blood, and from strangled, and from fornication.
Right? So isn't that interesting? He gave Paul a law. He said, we know you keep the law. Show all these people you keep the law. Look at all our brothers who keep the law, and they believe. Right? He gave to the Gentiles. He's like, now concerning the Gentiles, you know we didn't tell them that they had to keep that. But what does our law say about the Gentile concerning the law?
The Gentiles stay in our nation. He counted as a brother.
They said, the book tell us very clearly. The law, it tell us very clearly. The Gentile, or it don't say Gentile, it said the stranger or the sojourner amongst you, there will be one law one for the sojourner amongst you, one for the stranger amongst you, and one for you. All one law. Everybody going to do the same thing. They live in there, then they live in according to this law. So now why is it that the Gentile can do one thing and our people doing another thing? Right? We have to be able to understand the complexities of what's going on and make it simple. Right? Because what's made it is not that it's all that complex, really. What's made it complex is that we've been told lies and we believe them for so long. Right? When it comes to this book, everybody's been saying it's law or not law. Right? When that's not the case at all. It's Yahushua. It's Yahushua. What did Yahushua command for us to do? Right? So now this is what he put out in front of Paul. He told him, look, man, go ahead and take care of this stuff so these people know where you're from. Right? Keep going.
Then Paul took the men, and the next day, purifying himself with them, entered into the temple to signify the accomplishment of the days of purification until that an offering should be offered for every one of them. Mm-hmm. And when the 7 days were almost ended, the Jews which were of Asia, when they saw him in the temple, stirred up all the people and laid hands on him.
Right? You remember, that's where he was, right? He was in Asia. And when they say Asia, it's not talking about like China and nothing like that. It's talking about what's now known as Turkey. You know what I'm saying? So when the people that was over in that area of Turkey, you know what I'm saying? When they saw him down there, they were Jews and they was around there. You remember, we just got reading, Paul was over there, and everywhere he went, it was a big fuss. Right? So they knew Paul. So they came back. They coming back for the feast just like Paul was. And so now they come back. They there. Paul there. And they like, well, that's the dude that's just starting all this trouble. So James saw it coming already. He already knew. He was like, man, it's a whole lot of talk. People think you don't keep the law, and they think you teaching people to go against the law. He's like, man, make sure these people know that's nonsense and that you keep the law yourself. You know what I'm saying? Go take this vow. Right? Watch this. Keep going. Watch what Paul got to deal with. And remember, while we reading it, remember that we read months ago, we read about how Yahushua called Paul, right? And he told Paul that he would suffer for his name's sake. He gave him the expectation. He told him, this is what you're going to have to go through, right? He told him that. Now watch what happens. Keep going.
And when they saw him in the temple, stirred up all the people and laid hands on him, crying out, men of Israel, help. This is the man that teaches all men everywhere against the people and the law in this place, and further brought Greeks also into the temple and has polluted this holy place.
All right. So they told him, like, man, he brought some Greeks in there. I saw him. I saw him bring some Greeks in there and it polluted. That's against our law. Right. He said, I saw some Greeks go up in there. Right. And they polluted the place. Let's see.
For they had seen before with him in the city of Trophimus and Ephesian, whom they supposed that Paul had brought into the temple. And all the city was moved, and the people ran together, and they took Paul and drew him out of the temple. And forthwith the doors were shut. Mm-hmm. As they went about to kill him, tidings came unto the chief captain of the band that all Jerusalem was in an uproar.
Right, so they're about to kill Paul. And once they went about to kill him, then tidings came to the chief captain. Right, tidings. That he got word that they was up in an uproar. So he was looking like, oh, let me go calm these Jews down. You have to understand that these people, these officers and these rulers that were over Jerusalem, they were in a tight spot. Because the emperor of Rome at the time, what he was trying to do is he was trying to make sure that if I put you over somebody, you can keep all these people in control. Right? He was trying to make sure that everybody can stay in control. Everything stays calm. Continue to collect money from all these places. If we got to go to war with all these people, that loses us money. You know what I'm saying? It's easier and more profitable if we can just collect money from all these places. They pay their taxes. Everything's smooth. Keep the people down. So when they see people in the uproar, they want to resolve it quickly before word get back to the emperor. Right? So let's see. Keep going. Let's see what he do about it.
And as they went about to kill him, tidings came unto the chief captain of the band that all Jerusalem was in an uproar, who immediately took soldiers and centurions and ran down unto them. And when they saw the chief captain of the soldiers, they left beating Paul.
They see the soldiers coming. They stopped beating his butt. After that, they're like, all right. You know what I'm saying? So let's see what happened next.
Then the chief captain came near and took him and commanded him to be bound with two chains, and demanded who he was and what he had done. Mm-hmm. And some cried one thing and some another among the multitude. And when he could not know the certainty for the tumult.
All that's saying is that the people were going crazy. It was making a whole bunch of noise. So he couldn't tell with certainty what they was really saying. So what his real crime was. He asked the people, he's like, all right, what'd he do? You know what I'm saying? He see everybody trying to kill him. So he grab him up. You know what I'm saying? He like, okay, so what'd he do? Everybody yelling, he did that. So he couldn't tell with certainty. So let's see what happened.
And commanded him to be carried into the castle.
Okay.
And when he came upon the stairs, so it was that he was borne of the soldiers for the violence of the people.
All right. So the soldiers had to hold him up, is what they're saying. When they say borne of him, he had to hold him up. All right, beating his butt. You know what I'm saying? So they had to hold him up. What else?
For the multitude of the people followed after, crying away with him.
Mm-hmm.
And as Paul was to be led into the castle, he said unto the chief captain, may I speak unto thee?
He said, what? May I speak unto thee? Watch this.
Who said, canst thou speak Greek?
So he said it to him in his language. He said, may I speak unto thee? And then now, man, the captain was like, oh, you speak Greek? Watch what Paul say.
Art not thou that Egyptian which bore these days madness, madest up an uproar, which before these days made it up an uproar, and led us out into the wilderness 4,000 men that were murderers?
Right. So he said, aren't you the Egyptian? Remember, Egyptians was black, right? That's how you know Paul was black. That's how you know our people was black. Right? Egyptian was black. He said, he looked at him, he said, ain't you that Egyptian? He confused him with a black man. Right? Because he's a black man. He's like, man, ain't you that Egyptian that was running around, making all that noise, you know what I'm saying? You led these people out into the desert, right? That's what he thought he was. Let's see.
But Paul said, I am a man which am a Jew of Tarsus, mm-hmm. a city in Cilicia, and a citizen of no mean city, and mm-hmm. I beseech thee, suffer me to speak unto the people.
Right? So he said, man, just let me speak unto the people. So he spoke to this man in Greek. After he spoke to him in Greek, he was like, oh, this ain't no regular Hebrew here. He was like, you know what I'm saying, you speak Greek? So he was like, oh, you of Tarsus. That means you a Greek citizen, right? So you remember, this is not the first time. We read a probably about a month ago, Paul, he used his citizen card, you know what I'm saying, when he is out there in Turkey, you know what I'm saying? He used his citizen card. He was like, oh, no, I'm a citizen. They had him in jail. But he was like, me being a Roman citizen, you know what I'm saying? You going to just try to release me like that? He's like, nah, I want to see my trial. I want my trial date. You know what I'm saying? They're like, listen, just go away kindly. They're trying to get him up out of there because they put him in jail without cause. So he used his card. All right? Let's see how he uses it now. It's Roman card. I've been saying Greek. He uses Roman card. Watch this.
And when he had given him license, Paul stood on the stairs and beckoned with the hand unto the people.
So he went up there and he started signaling to the people like, hey, you know what I'm saying? I'm trying to talk. You know what I'm saying? So the people got quiet. Watch this.
When there was made a great silence, he spake unto them in the Hebrew tongue, saying.
He spake unto them in the what?
Hebrew tongue.
You got a lot of people that tell you lie, talking about they didn't even speak Hebrew at that time. They were speaking Aramaic. If you remember, people say they speak Aramaic. If you remember when Pontius Pilate had something written above the cross, what languages did he have them written in?
Greek, Latin, and Hebrew.
I ain't hear nothing about no Aramaic, though. He had it written in three languages, Greek, Latin, and Hebrew. Why not Aramaic? If that's what everybody was speaking in that region, as these super smart people try to tell us, if everybody was speaking Aramaic in that region, then why was Aramaic the only language that people could speak that wasn't on there? Latin was on there, Greek was on there, and what else? Hebrew. Right? But people make that argument because they don't want to have to deal with the true name of Yahushua. Right? We sit here, it don't matter what we call them. They didn't even call them Yahushua back then. They spake Aramaic. That make it real easy for you. That make it real nice for you, huh? They spoke Hebrew. Stop all that lying. All right, keep going. So he spoke to him in the Hebrew tongue,
saying, men, brother, and fathers, hear ye my defense, which I make now unto you.
Uh-huh.
And when they heard that he spake in the Hebrew tongue to them, they kept the more silence. And he said, I am verily a man, which am a Jew, born in Tarsus, a city of Cilicia. Yet brought up in this city at the feet of Gamaliel, and taught according to the perfect manner of the law of the fathers, and was zealous towards God, as ye all are today. And I persecuted this way unto the death, binding and delivering unto prisons both men and women. As also the high priest does bear me witness, and all the estate of the elders, from whom also I received letters unto the brethren, and went to Damascus to bring them which were there bound unto Jerusalem for to be punished. And it came to pass that as I made my journey, and was come nigh unto Damascus about noon, suddenly there shone from heaven a great light round about me. And I fell unto the ground, and heard a voice saying unto me, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And I answered, Who art thou, Lord? And he said unto me, I am Yahushua of Nazareth, whom you persecutest. And they that were with me saw indeed the light, and were afraid, but they heard not the voice of him that spake to me. And I said, What shall I do, Lord? And the Lord said unto me, Arise, and go to Damascus, and there shall be told thee of all things which are appointed for thee to do. And when I could not see for the glory of that, for the glory of that light, being led by the hand of them that were with me, I came into Damascus. And one Ananias, a devout man according to the law, having a good rapport of all the Jews which dwelt there, came unto me and stood, and said unto me, Brother Saul, receive thy sight. And the same hour I looked upon him. And he said, The God of our fathers has chosen thee, that you should know his will, and see that just one, and shouldest hear the voice of his sound, his mouth. For thou shalt be his witness unto all men that you have seen and heard. And now, why tarriest thou? Arise and be baptized, and wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord. And it came to pass that when I was come again into Jerusalem, even while I prayed in the temple, I was in a trance. And I saw him saying unto me, Make haste, and get thee quickly out of Jerusalem, for they will not receive thy testimony concerning me. And I said, Lord, they know that I am imprisoned and beaten every synagogue, them that believed on you. And when the blood of thy martyr Stephen was shed, I was also standing by and consenting unto his death, and kept the raiment of them that slew him. And he said unto me, Depart, for I will send thee far hence unto the Gentiles.
And he said, I'm going to send you where?
Far hence unto the Gentiles.
So he's telling us all the things that he did against Yahushua, right? He's reminding us of all the stuff that we already read in Acts, of all the things he did against Yahushua. Then at the end of it, he is like, nah, get up out of there. They ain't going to believe you. Go ahead and go to the Gentiles. Watch this.
And they gave him audience unto this word, and then lift up their voices and said.
As soon as he said Gentile, it has a whole lot changed. The Hebrew Israelites who know we Hebrews has a whole lot changed. As soon as he got talking about the Gentiles, hey there. Oh, we don't want to hear nothing else. Watch what they did.
And they gave him audience unto this word, and then lift up their voices and said, Away with such a fellow from the earth, for it is not fit that he should live. And as they cried out and cast off their clothes and threw dust into the air, the chief captain commanded him to be brought to the castle and bade that he should be examined by scourging, that he might know wherefore they cried so against him. And as they bound him with thongs, Paul said unto the centurion that stood by, Is it lawful for you to scourge a man that is a Roman and uncondemned? Then the centurion heard that. He went and told the chief captain, saying, Take heed that thou doest, for this man is a Roman. Take heed what thou doest, for this man is a Roman.
So he playing his Roman card again.
Then the chief captain came and said unto him, Tell me, art thou a Roman? And he said, Yeah. And the chief captain answered, With a great sum obtained I this freedom. And Paul said, But I was free born. Then straightway they departed from him, which should have examined him. And the chief captain also was afraid after he knew that he was a Roman, and because he had bound him. On the morrow, because he would have known the certainty wherefore he was accused of the Jews, he loosed him from his bands and commanded the chief priests and all their council to appear, and brought Paul down and set him before them. And Paul, earnestly beholding the council, said, Men and brethren, I have lived in all good conscience before God unto this day. And the high priest Ananias commanded them that stood by to smite him on the mouth.
He said, so the high priest Ananias, he commanded. Remember, Paul's still running his darn mouth. They don't like nothing that he's talking about. He's talking about going off to the Gentiles, We know our God don't mess with no darn Gentiles. What's wrong with what he's talking about? That's how our people are thinking right now. They is with him and they're talking about all this stuff. And it's like, oh, that's what happened. He's speaking in Hebrew and all that. And as soon as he got to talking about God sending him to the Gentiles, like, oh, man, we ain't listening to this noise. Man ought to be dead. Right? So they start, you know, causing another uproar. And after that, the high priest, he commanded somebody that was standing there. He's like, slap his butt. Watch what he said.
And the high priest Ananias commanded them that stood by him to smite him on the mouth. Then Paul said unto him, God shall smite thee, thou whited wall. For right. Sittest thou to judge me after the law, and commandest me to be smitten contrary to the law?
Right, so Paul, he's like, man, somebody going to smite you. God going to smite you, right? You whited wall, and whited wall just saying that, you know what I'm saying, the outside of you is clean, but the inside is dirty. You know what I'm saying? He said, you whited wall. You know what I'm saying? How you going to tell somebody to smite me against the law, and you going to supposed to be the one to stand for the law? Right? But watch what happened now.
And they that stood by said, revilest thou God's high priest?
Right? So they looked at him and it's like, oh, you reviling the high priest, huh? That's against our law.
Then said Paul,
hold on, let me guess what Paul going to say. Because the law do say, thou shalt not revile, you know what I'm saying, or blaspheme the high priest. I mean, you know what I'm saying, the leader of your people. You know what I'm saying? So the book do say that. The law do say that. So let me guess what Paul going to say. Because Paul, he's an apostle, and he know he an apostle. So surely he ain't going, you know what I'm saying, you know what I'm saying. Surely it's some loophole or something he can be in. So Paul probably going to come back and be like, you know what I'm saying, I'm higher than the high priest because I was chosen by God and y'all sinners. Let me see.
Then Paul said, I wist not, brethren, that he was the high priest.
He said, I didn't know it. He is the high priest. Oh, I didn't know it.
For it is written, thou shalt not speak evil of the ruler of thy people.
Right? What are you going to do other than repent? He's saying, I shouldn't have did it. I shouldn't have did it. You know what I'm saying? He said, the book tell me clearly I shouldn't do that. He's the ruler of our people. Right? That's what we have to do. He didn't spend a whole lot of time. No, I didn't sin. Is that nothing? He ain't got no time for none of that. He said, you know what I'm saying? You right. Shouldn't have did it. Right? Move on. He said, I wish not. He was the high priest. Right? Keep going.
But when Paul perceived that the one part were Sadducees and the other Pharisees, he cried out in the council, men and brethren, I am a Pharisee, the son of a Pharisee. Of the hope and resurrection of the dead, I am called in question. Right. And when he had so said, there arose dissension between the Pharisees and Sadducees, and the multitude was divided.
Right, so they got divided because the Sadducees didn't believe none of that foolishness.
He did that one on purpose.
Yeah, they didn't believe none of that foolishness. Looking like, man, we don't believe no resurrection of the dead, no spirits, none of this craziness y'all be talking about. The Pharisees did believe that stuff. So he started an argument between them. They all together against him. He was like, hey, I was raised at the feet of Gamaliel now. You know what I'm talking about? I'm a Pharisee of Pharisees. What y'all talking about? They got me questioned because I believe in the resurrection of the dead. So what do you think the Sadducees are going to do? They're going to look over and be like, look at the Pharisees like, y'all know it ain't no resurrection of the dead. So they start arguing back and forth after that. He's trying to get out and die, right? Let's see.
For the Sadducees say that there is no resurrection, mm-hmm. neither angel nor spirit, but the Pharisees confess both. Mm-hmm. And there arose a great cry, and the scribes that were of the Pharisees part arose and strove, saying, we find no evil in this man. Mm-hmm. But if a spirit or an angel has spoken to him, let us not fight against God. And when there arose a great dissension, the chief captain, fearing lest Paul should have been pulled in pieces of them, mm-hmm. commanded the soldiers to go down and take him by force from among them, and to bring him into the castle. Mm-hmm. And the night following, the Lord stood by him and said, "Be of good cheer, Paul, for as thou hast testified of me in Jerusalem, so much thou bear witness also at Rome."
Right. So you look at that. All that Paul just went through. Not to even mention the stuff that he went through before he got there. The Most High God spoke to him and said, "Oh, don't worry about it. You're gonna have to keep going. You have to do the same thing in Rome." Right? And remember, the whole way getting there, they was telling Paul. Prophets were coming up to Paul like, look, man, you don't want to go to Jerusalem. When you go to Jerusalem, they're going to bind you up. Well, that's exactly what happened. Now he's bound. He's in jail. When they say take him to the castle, it ain't because he's chilling. He's in jail. Right? These are things that he had to suffer. But notice that he told us that he went through all these things, and we remember that Yahushua appeared to him and told him, you will suffer for my name. He's let it out for him. He told him, this is what you have up against you. This is what you have to look forward to if you come in this way. This is Luke chapter 14. It's no different than what he did to the men who came up to him talking about, I will follow you. He told them, foxes ain't got no darn holes. You sure you want to follow me? He made sure it was full disclosure. Paul took after the same thing. He went to the people and he was preaching to the people in Ephesus. And he says, I didn't hold back from you the fullness of the counsel of God. Full disclosure. That's what it's about, making sure people understand what they're getting into. If they don't understand, then they get halfway there and want to turn around. That's what Luke chapter 14 about to tell us. Luke chapter 14, verse 25. All right? Because you get there and you realize, you know what? I'm not built for this. Most High God is trying to save you a little bit of trouble. I'll let you know up front what you got to do. You just tell me if you're ready for it or not. It's Luke chapter 14, verse 25.
And there went great multitudes with him, and he turned and said unto them, if any man come to me.
So great multitudes are following them the Christians. So a whole bunch of Christians. He wouldn't have no business talking or turning around talking to some disciples about this. It wouldn't make sense. They've already chosen to follow him. They already know. He turned around. He talked to the great multitudes that followed him. If somebody is a follower of Christ, by definition, that makes them a Christian. Right? So these are great multitudes that followed him. And watch what he turned around and said.
If any man come to me and hate not his mother.
If you don't hate not his mama.
Hate not his father.
You don't hate your pops.
And his mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters. Yea. And his own life also.
You got to hate your own life too.
He cannot be my disciple.
There's no way you can be my disciple. The disciple. Notice what he's saying. He didn't say nothing about a follower. He didn't say nothing. You can't be my Christian. You can't be my Hebrew Israelite. He said, there's no way you can be my disciple. Right? You have to hate all these things I just told you, or else you can't be my disciple. When we look at hate, what he's talking about, he's talking about comparatively. You know what I'm saying? You can't put these people over me. Right? When it comes to my word, these people cannot come over me. Let's read it one more time. I just want to see what he listed out. See if anybody got missed.
If any man come to me and hate not his father.
Gotta hate your pop.
And mother.
And mom.
And his wife. And wife. And children.
And children.
And brethren.
And brethren.
And sisters.
And sisters.
Yea, and his own life also.
And his own life also. So that go, if he is speaking to a woman, it'd be husband, right? Same thing, right?
He cannot be my disciple.
He said, you cannot, it's impossible to be his disciple. Watch this. That thing tough. That thing real hard. But you see, these are people who were following him. This is not people that's like, oh, I don't believe in God, this, that, and other. These are people that's like, oh, what do we do? How do I make it? I want to be a disciple. I want to be somebody who's like you. He turned around and tell them, oh, you got to hate all this. He didn't tell, oh, please, just come. Just come. Let me show you. He said, let me just let you know right off top. Unless you hate your pops, your mom, your wife, your children, your brother and your sister, there's no way you can be my disciple. Watch what he say next.
And whosoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot
whosoever
be my disciple.
Whosoever does not what?
Bear his cross.
I mean, you got to suffer. That's what the cross represents. He ain't talking about go get you a gold cross, a Jesus piece, and none of that foolishness he people be talking about. He's saying, you have to suffer. When he bore his cross, it was to suffer. He said, if you're not going to suffer in the way that I suffer for the people, then don't even try it. That's what Paul was up for. Paul knew about it beforehand. Right? The prophets came and warned. What do you think the prophet will come in and warn them for? They're doing the same thing that he's doing. These people say they want to follow him. And we saw all the prophets, all through Acts. We saw the prophet coming up to Paul saying, man, the man who wear, they took a belt off of him, tied his arms up with it. The man who owned this belt, he gonna get wrapped up and be bound and sent to Jerusalem. They told him, man, when you go to Jerusalem, man, I don't think you coming back. They start crying. They're like, man, why y'all break my heart? Not only am I going to go, I'm willing to die for this. What y'all talking about? Paul knew what he was up against. He knew what he was going down there for. Because the Most High God gave full disclosure. He let him know, this is what you're going to be going. He didn't come trick him, trying to woo him and none of that. This is what you up against, and it's going to be real tough. You up for it? Paul Paul got to look at that law. Now, that's easy. Got to. Got to look at it. It's easy compared to the stuff that you're about to give me. That thing easy. That got to be the attitude. Watch this. Keep going.
For which of you intending to build a tower sits not down first?
This is a parable. He says, now which one of y'all, if y'all intended to build a tower, you don't sit down first and do what?
And count the cost, whether he have sufficient to finish it.
Right? Do you have enough money to finish this tower? I'm going to start a building, and I'm not even sure if I got enough money to build it all the way to the top, to paint it when I'm done, to put doors on it, put my alarm system. He's like, I mean, who going to sit here and build the building? You ain't even got enough money to finish it to make it profitable to you. Right? Who's going to do that? It makes sense. If somebody started right now, just like, you know what, I want to start construction. I want to build a building so I can put all my employees in it. We'd call them foolish if they started it and halfway through they're like, man, I just didn't have enough money to finish it. Right? We'd call them foolish. Like, man, that's just bad business. You wasted all that money. Couldn't even finish it. Right? That's what Yahushua is trying to tell us. He says the same thing. Why would you try to come this way? Does it sound like he's trying to trick people into coming? He'd be giving full disclosure. This is what you up against. Make sure you can handle it. He said, why would you come this way if you know that you can't do it? If you know you ain't even got the mind to do it. Right? Keep going.
Less happily, after he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish it, and all that behold it began to mock him.
Uh-huh.
Saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish.
Right? He said, people won't start mocking. You don't think that's going to happen? You come this way? We see it happen all the time when these people try to be Christian. Right? They try to be Christian. Oh, I love it. And you know, Christian, they teach you. They teach you, put that thing out there. So they all over fail, praise God. I'm just so happy he changed my life. And they be putting themselves all the way out there. Doing all this stuff, still hypocrite, and still going to the club. Doing all this stuff. One girl, I mean, I was so proud of her. She changed a lot. She had a rough life. You know what I'm saying? I know some people that know her, so I know it's true. She had a rough life. And then she started going to this church and started trying to change and doing all these things. But it's a Christian church. You know what I'm saying? So it ain't no power in it. It's no promise connect. It's not about the people, right? It's really not about the people. When I talk about the Christians, it's not about the people. They're not connecting to anything with power. They're not connecting to anything with a promise with it. You calling yourself a Christian, what does that mean? It means nothing. It doesn't have anything. It's not anything that God said, do this and I'll give you this. When we call ourselves disciples, we call ourselves children of God, things of that nature. When that's how we identify naturally, then that means something. That has something, that has a connotation to it. That brings something, right? If our behavior line up with it, at least. When you call yourself a Christian, one, they don't have a standard of behavior. You know what I'm saying? Not a real one. It's just like, do the best you can. So you see it and you start doing the best you can and you start finding out that the best you can just get worse and worse all the time. Then she end up back in the same life and even worse than she did. Got married, got divorced, right? And just start doing all types of stuff, right? Falling back into the same life that she in now. Now she into the point where she don't believe none of this stuff. Right? She don't believe none of it. That's what we look at. That's why it gets dangerous, because you enter into this saying, I'm building this building. And once you don't build it, once you get to the middle of it and you can't finish it, everybody laughing at you. Everybody mocking. How you think that make God look? Right? That's why they blaspheme his name. Not on account of anything that God doing. God ain't never did nothing to cause anybody to blaspheme his name. They blaspheme him based off of what we do, what these people do in his name. Right? That's why you think it's in his benefit to let you know, this is what you got to deal with. You really up for this? Let me just get you out the way right now. I don't want you representing me. You get halfway there and people start laughing at you, trying to say, this is my work. Look, God building this building for me. I get halfway done. Oh, I ain't even got enough to build it. How'd that look on God? God didn't give you what you... What do you think? What did Moses say? When Moses... When we went into the wilderness and most of our God was like, I'm about to kill off all these people. Moses was like, no, Lord. Right? You kill them off now, these people going to be like, oh, so most of our God brought them into the wilderness, but he didn't have what it takes to get them into the land. And you saw the most of our God was like, you're right. I'll leave them alone. right? And he didn't take it because that's what the Most High God is looking at. They're going to cause the people to blaspheme if I got rid of these people in the wilderness. I just get rid of all the older ones. I bring the young ones in. Right? That's what we have to look at. He is looking at, if we can't finish the job, don't even start. That's why he told the man, anybody who put his hand to the plow and look back, you ain't fit for the kingdom. That thing don't even make sense. Right? We got to finish the job. We got to be in it for the long haul. And we got to know up front. Right? Otherwise, we just in here making a fool out of ourselves. Watch what he say next. He got another parable for us before we get out of here.
Or what king going to make war against another king sits not down first and consults whether he be able with 10,000 to meet him that comes against him with 20,000?
Mm-hmm.
Or else, while the other is yet a great way off, he sends an embassage and desire conditions of peace. So likewise, whosoever he be of you that forsakes but not all that he has, he cannot be my disciple.
Mm-hmm.
Salt is good, but if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith shall it be seasoned? It is neither fit for the land nor yet for the dunghill.
In other words, he's saying salt is good, but if you don't have no flavor in your salt, the only reason you're using salt on your food, because it gives flavor. If you don't have flavor on your salt, it's worthless. People are going to throw it out. He said the same thing with us, right? He said, it's good to follow the Most High God. But if you, in the midst of following, you lose the power that he's offering to you, or you lose the zeal that he's calling you with, he said, then you're worthless. And that's what John the Baptist, in the beginning of what we're talking about, that's what he was talking about. He said, the axe is at the root. He said, now all this stuff about to go. He said, I'm about to put all this stuff in the fire. That's what the Most High God is trying to prevent. He's trying to let us know, if you're going to go to the fire, you might as well live it up right now. Don't try to come this way if you're trying to go to the fire. That's going to make it difficult for you. Right? If you're going to the fire, I mean, you just go there and have fun while you're doing it. Right? Make it worth it. Try to at least. Right? He said, if you're coming this way, just make sure you're ready for it. He gave him a warning, full disclosure. That's a sign of what he's going to do for all disciples. He's going to let you know right up front, this is what you have to do. This is what you have to look forward to. All right? Let's go back to John chapter 7, verse. We start at 14, so verse 17 maybe. All right, that's too far down. John chapter 7, verse 15, 16. Let's say 16.
And the Jews marveled, saying, how knoweth this man letters, having never learned?
This is verse 16?
15.
So the Jews marveled, this is verse 15, saying, the Jews marveled, saying, how does he know these letters? Keep going.
And Yahshua answered them and said, my doctrine is not mine, but his that sent me.
That's what we're reading right now, right? That's what we're reading. We ain't reading about me. We ain't reading about no other pastor or anybody else. We're not reading about how I know letters or how I know the book. We reading his book, right? Half of the time, what y'all hearing, y'all not hearing me talk. Y'all hearing T talk, and he reading from the book, right? So we have to ask ourselves, how in the world does Yahushua know this stuff, right? Watch what he say to us.
If any man do his will, he shall know the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself.
He said, if you do his will, you will know for sure whether it's of God, whether he speak of himself. That's what we're here to do, is his will. Go ahead and pray out.